Any other?
I do have another question, but I'll let Abdul go.
It looked like Michael had a question. Or...
Yeah, I do. It's like one of the first things you said. Just to be clear, you said that the Permian wasn't a classic Foreland Basin. It was...
No.
That's where I lost you right there. It was...
So, you know, kind of an antiquated view that I think is not embraced by most recent workers is that this was a Ouachita Foreland. And there is a foreland basin called the Belle Verde that's quite narrow and has a wolf camp and even upper pen sort of fleece sequence. But most of the basin is far afield from that. And the most common orientation on these reverse faults is north-south, which makes no sense with the direction of, kind of impingement of Gondwana. And the timing is also different of the Belle Verde from the Ouachita system. It continues younger. So I think it's a hybrid is one way to view it, is that there is a foreland associated with the Marathon orogenic belt, but it's also more similar to these ancestral Rocky Mountain basins, which have basement cord uplifts. And in some cases, I think there is the deepest part of the Delaware and Midland basins are right against the Central Basin platform. So I think there is at least a partial flexural effect from the basement uplifts like we see in the Laramide. So that's my view. And I think it's most workers' most modern view is to view this as having, both components, but that it's not driven from a simple Ouachita orogeny. It's more complicated than that.
Perfect. Thank you.
So, okay.
Okay, let's go with one more question and then we'll let you move on, Kurt.
Okay. Or not, it's fine too. Okay. Oh, Tyson, you're going to ask another question?
Well, I certainly don't have to.
It's okay. I'm just joking.
If there are other people, ask one, ask questions. I already asked one, so someone else can definitely jump in.
Let's go.
Okay. Another question is: have you done any substance analysis in the Delaware Basin between east and west? And the reason I ask is, again, when I worked for a very brief extent in the Permian in the Delaware Basin years ago, there was a difference in maturity. And even though it was structurally more shallow in the western portion of the Delaware Basin, it was much more gas rich. And there was a lot of kind of back and forth about why that was. I'm curious to know if any of the kind of subsidence profiles that you created kind of teased apart an east or west portion of that Delaware Basin.
No, I've only got eight burial histories in the Permian Basin, and the two in the Delaware are kind of on the north-south axis. There's more and more exhumation as you go to the west associated with this basin and range, and there's always an open question of how much post-Permian or even latest Permian like Rustler, Salado, did you have there? So there's a question of how much additional burial has been stripped off and not recorded. And so, you'd have to have calibrate the burial histories. That would be fairly easy to do. And obviously Thermochron would maybe be an ancillary addition to that. But I'm not, I don't know any more than that. Sorry.
No,
okay. Okay, we're going to go back and we're moving on to the quads now. So this is a chronostrat chart. That's kind of my own version of things that we're going to look at several times. So these are the North American stages and series in the Permian. And what's shown to the left is always going to be the proximal deposits, which on the platforms tend to be carbonate prone, shown in blue. And then basinward to the right, and we'll talk about these basin restricted siliciclastics. And then in the most up-dip areas, these pink colors and these little sands, that basically represents transition into sabka, evaporites, red beds, and hypersaline dolomites. So we're going to start at the bottom of the exposures that we see in the Guadalupe Mountains, which is the upper part of the Lenardian. And we'll look at this Victorio Peak to Bone Spring, and that's equivalent to the Clear Fork, upper part of the Clear Fork and the subsurface. We're going to look at this cutoff interval, which is an outcrop term really only. It's not widely used in the subsurface. Its updip equivalent is the lower San Andres. In the subsurface, they will lump the cutoff with the Bone Spring, even though it's vastly different in ages. But that's lithostratigraphy for you. And then we're going to look at the lowermost exposed thick siliciclastic deposit. So that's where we're going. So here we're headed to the Guadalupe Mountains. This is basically the escarpment held up by the normal faults. This is the reef escarpment. And these are the Delaware Mountains to the south. And so we're going to see all of those today. Again, this is a little more up close and personal. You see the reef escarpment, these normal faults. This relief here from the Guadalupe Mountains to the Delaware Mountains is paleobathymetry, basically because of the exhumation and the removal of the overlying evaporites. So the first place we're going to go is going to be these Bone and Chouinard Canyons on the western escarpment. And this is a oblique aerial view. So you can see nicely exposed the rim of the Delaware Basin, with this being the northwest shelf behind. So this is basically crudely exhumed four reef slopes into the basin. And you see them sweeping down, and this relief into the Delaware Mountains is the approximate paleobathymetric relief. And the traverse we're going to do is from Chouinard Canyon up across the top and down Bone Canyon. Again, this is normal faults here that have popped these up in Miocene through today. And, this is weird. So this is a rather nice Bureau of Economic Geology cross-section that Charlie and others have put together some time ago based on a whole bunch of measured sections. And so this is the chronostratigraphy, and it shows this basically Victoria Peak to Bone Spring transition from platform carbonates to the slope. And then we're going to look at this little thin unit called the cutoff, and then the Brushy Canyon, which onlaps onto those sequence boundaries. We're going to first look at an air photo of the western escarpment shown here in red. So it includes all this ensuing stratigraphy up to near the top of the Guadalupian. So here's a kind of distant view of the whole thing, and then we'll step through a bunch of panels. So this is about where the pan is. This is back when we were allowed to do overflights on schools. So we kind of fly back and forth across this and look at things. So we're going to start at the left or north side, below Bush Mountain, and move all the way to El Capitan, and in a series of panels. And I'll try and describe what we see. And these are a series of composite measured sections that I've put together from various published authors, a whole wide collection of them. So what we see as we're furthest up dip, we have the rather flat-lying platform carbonates of the Victoria Peak. We have this thin, poorly exposed cutoff unit. Then there's a series of siltstones of the Cherry Canyon and little tongues of carbonates. Then we go through some proud cliffs, and this is the Grayberg Formation, and that's capped by an unconformity that we see here in red. And so there's enormous amount of relief on this, several hundred meters of erosion where it's eroded back into the platform sediment, so we actually don't see the preserved depositional margin. And when you go, and I've actually been here a long time ago when I was young and fit, and you actually see debrites at the base here, but there's no siliciclastics or anything, and you basically very rapidly you go back into carbonate deposition of the Goat Seep, and it's a shelfward equivalent to Queen. So we're going to follow this along and see what happens, especially to this lower unit, which we care most about. And as we go over to Bartlett to Chouinard Peak, we see here is the flat-lying Victoria Peak. See how these cliffs are really thick bedded and well exposed. And then this lower part is much more softly eroding and thinner bedded. And this represents the facies transition of this prograding system between the platform carbonates of the Victoria Peak and the slope and basinal limestones, mudstones and wacky stones of the Bone Spring. And then we also see this unconformity, which we call the GP2 sequence boundary, GP4. So I'm using Exxon nomenclature. If those of you who are into the Bureau stuff, they have the same kind of abbreviations, but they have many, many dozens of sequence boundaries because they count all the fourth order ones, and I'm just going to emphasize the third order ones. So there's going to be a little disconnect between the nomenclature. So this is actually cut down through the upper part of the Victoria Peak, similar to what we saw in that Grayberg cut. And these units that are more tan colored to red brown colored on top are all siliciclastics of the Brushy Canyon. And this Brushy Canyon is onlapping, and we'll look at that a little more closely, the sequence boundary. It's about up to 500 meters thick in the basin, and it onlaps to zero over a space of about 20 kilometers. And we see the sweeping down of these cliniforms of the youngest Guadalupian margins, which we'll talk about next time. And you're also starting to see some dips within the Bone Spring representing the slope deposits there. And then as we go further to the south, we see this eroded slope coming down on these two sequence boundaries. This one is the top of the Victoria Peak. It's the LD10. And here's the one that's the base of the Brushy Canyon, the GP2. This is the top of the Brushy Canyon. So you see how thick it's gotten. And the traverse we're going to do in just a second is going up Chouard Canyon, up the Park Service Trail. Then you go up over the top, and we're going to look back at Williams Gulch here, drop down into Bone Canyon, and back out to the old ranch house at Williams Ranch House. Incidentally, this is called Stratotype Canyon because this is the global reference section for the Middle Permian. It's defined here based on excellent biostratigraphy that they have through this succession here. So this is a cross-section I referenced that's cobbled together from, you know, a plethora of sources. But what this shows, and this is just a portion of it, it shows that these lavender beds are the dolostones. This is a grain size column using the Dunham classification for the carbonates, and then this for this siliciclastics. These are sands versus silts. And so what you see is that overall this Bone Spring Victoria Peak section is basically coarsening up. It's a progradational second order high stand, but then it's terminated by this unconformity at the LD10. And then we have this weird unit that we're going to talk a lot about on top called the cutoff. And that, even in a shelfable position, represents mostly mudstones and siliceous wacky stones and pack stones, et cetera, at best. So even perched on top of these grain stones of the Victoria Peak, it represents lower energy deposition. And then on top of that is the GP2 sequence boundary, and this is the onlap of the Brushy Canyon. We'll talk about this later on as a TOC profile to indicate where the source rocks are and how that relates to the sequence stratigraphy. So the traverse we're going to do is up this canyon and down that one. So we're going to be going up section and then distal and down section. So when you first leave the trail, what you see is in the North Chouard Canyon is we have these thick bedded dolostones of the Victoria Peak that are inclined from right to left. And then you see this sharp surface here. And we see onlap and convergence of these thinner bedded units of the lower cutoff. And that's the LD10 sequence boundary. Moreover, we also see truncation on this surface, and this is the GP1 sequence boundary. And this rather poorly exposed section is upper cutoff. And then,
yeah.
Okay, somebody's talking, but it's okay. And then not really exposed here is the GP2 sequence boundary. And here the Brushy Canyon is nothing but very fine-grained siltstone sitting on this. So keep that in mind. So the Victoria Peak here is these thick-bedded grain stones, pack stones, a lot of fusilinids, a lot of crinoid columnals, some solitary coral, rugosans. The lower cutoff is this medium-bedded skeletal wacky stone. And the upper cutoff is a thin-bedded spiculitic limestone mudstone. And we'll look at that in another exposure in a lot of detail, because it's a really important facies for unconventional resources. And then here, the lower brushy is this laminated siltstones, very fine grain, poorly exposed. The opposite side of the canyon, we see a similar thing. This is the Victoria Peak. You see how these are thick bedded, standing up kind of proud cliffs. And then here's the truncation associated with the LD10 sequence boundary. You actually see better evidence of the truncation at the GP1. And then in the distance, this is this whole section of Brushy Canyon, which is about 300 meters thick, and you see it kind of converging in the distance. At the resting on the LD10 sequence boundary, we have a conglomeratic unit, which are termed mega breccias here. They have outsized clasts floating in a limestone matrix. And because the clasts are basically poorly sorted, matrix supported, and show no internal stratification, they've been interpreted as debrites associated with the erosion on this unconformity. So we interpret these as being submarine canyon cuts into the underlying platform margin. And we'll build on that and how that influences sedimentation in a minute. So this is a view kind of from a distance as you kind of go over the hump between Shumard and Bowen Canyons. You see the top of the Victoria Peak climbing up into this stack of platformal carbonates here and changing character into the Bone Spring below. GP1's kind of hard to interpret, and then you see this big section of Brushy Canyon and the ultimate onlap here. This is Williams Gulch. We see the same thing again. There's the LD10 sequence boundary with cutoff resting on top unconformably. But we'll take a look at this interesting little outcrop here in the Brushy. It's got a channel morphology to it, and you see how discontinuous these sands are. There's a lot of sand up here, and there's nothing but siltstone over here. And so you can walk those beds out, and they basically those sands end. So this is a rather spectacular example. These are up to about 10 meters in scale, this inclined accretionary stratification. You can make kind of a poor analogy to a point bar. So this is lateral migration of the channel axis here, obviously in this really sandy system. And so these are interpreted as slope channels in a more proximal portion of a submarine fan system. So put this into perspective. This is a map done by Rick Boboff and Christine Ross and a couple of people I worked with for a long time. And it shows the discontinuity of these sands. So I was like saying a map is a cross-section and a cross-section is a map if you look at it correctly. So you can view this as kind of a cross-section. So we see the GP2, GP1, and LD10 sequence boundaries here. And Christine and Rick have defined two big sediment transport corridors here, one in this upper brushy position and one here in the middle brushy. And we'll talk more about that internal stratigraphy in a moment. And you see how these sands are thinning as they go out. Moreover, you see that in the axial position of these, we're cutting down through the entire cutoff succession. So we have thick brushy canyon sandstones and conglomerates sitting directly on Victoria Peak and Bone Spring. And the same thing is occurring in this position at Shirtail Canyon, where we've cut down through the entire cutoff succession. So these are point sources that are associated with submarine canyons that have eroded back into the carbonates. And that's our traverse. So this is from their Hedberg publication. So it's a little fuzzy, but we'll have to deal with it. This is a view again, air photo, shows the GP2 sequence boundary as it comes up, and it basically cuts up and retains some cutoff here, and that is the ultimate onlap of the Brushy Canyon Formation. And here's kind of an oblique view. That is that channel complex that we saw the accretionary cross stratification in. And here you see that this kind of confined slope channel complex is localized in this position. So here we have a submarine canyon fill, and here we have slope channels just down dip of that kind of system. So these are point sources associated with the submarine canyons. The sandstones are obviously better developed along these sediment transport corridors, and we would interpret them as confined slope channels. So regarding this onlap, you know, it's sort of an obvious stratigraphic trap. If you could have base seal and top seal is probably not an issue because we're going to have these siltstones on top. There are a few fields associated with this that are analogous, but it's not as common as you might expect it to be. This is from the first Bone Spring sand, which is another submarine fan. You see the structure map on the left. No structural closure here at all. And this is a net porous sand isopach. And you see there's a zero line. And that basically is the trapping mechanism for this field. There's also a field, unfortunately, named Avalon, that's not related to the Avalon zone in the Cherry Canyon and Brushy Canyon. Has a similar relationship. It's not actually as simple as just the onlap. It's a sort of a degradation in permeability close to the onlap, so it's a little more complicated than that, but this is a trap type in the basin. So I'd like to introduce a general model that we use here for the Delaware Mountain Group and specifically the Brushy Canyon. So what we have is the old carbonate margin here, shown with the light blue color to the left, upper left. And then we're having incision of that platform through a series of submarine canyons. And then this would be the inherited slope and then to basin floor transition. So this would be relatively flat, dipping and flat. And the dips in the Clear Fork equivalent Victoria Peak Bone Spring system around 5 degrees on average. So kind of not that steep for a carbonate, but really steep for a clastic system. So what we see in the updip parts, we have discontinuous development of sand. Some places it's just backfilled with siltstones. Some places you do see the sands preserved in these corridors. And we go into the upper slope, proximal slope channel complex. And that's shown diagrammatically here. So these are very confined. These particular ones don't have good levees developed for you deep water fans, but they do have all this overbank siltstones and thin low density turbidite equivalents. As we go down dip, these are basically becoming more distributive. So they change their aspect ratio, becoming broader, not as incised. And eventually we're gonna terminate through this channel to sheet transition and finally see more sheet-like geometries in the basin floor position. So these are very confined. They have a much poorer lateral connectivity or amalgamation, but good opportunities for vertical amalgamation. These sheet complexes have good lateral connectivity, but if there's abandonment surfaces here, we'll not have good vertical connectivity. So before we drop into Bone Canyon and look at one of these axial positions on these in the slope position, just again, just to say that, you know, this is damn consistent. We have our GP1 LD10 merge sequence boundary here. It's terminating the Bone Spring. We have mega breccias developed. This is a really thick one that's about 15 meters in thickness developed on this incision. And then here's the base of the Brushy Canyon, the GP2. So note the faces change from where we started in the Victoria Peak. Now here at the top of that high stand sequence set, we're seeing this very thin bedded lime mudstones and wacky stones, siliceous, usually a lot of chert in it as well. So I just like to riff on that for a little bit. So let's look at this, what the subsurface shows for this Victoria Peak to Bone Spring transition, because it's an important reservoir type. This is from Steve Ruppel's work. So again, you know, we have relatively lower dips on the slope here. These tend to be grainy. So these are grainy margins. There may be some isolated buildups that are related to calcareous sponges or rugosans. But generally what we're seeing in this kind of platform margin position is grainstone pack stones. Eventually we'll go into a platform interior and evaporative succession. And we'll look more at that kind of relationship on the second module. Down dip, these are transitioning into these cherty mudstones until we get into the basically the basin floor. So the reservoirs, best reservoirs, are in these grainy deposits. You do have an opportunity for a facies change related stratigraphic trap as we go into the anhydrites of the platform interior. And so here's some reservoir types. You have these are moldic expressions of fuselinated pack stones, some coated grains, and then these are fenestrae, which are these little degassing voids that occur in upper intertidal to lower supratidal carbonate systems, and we'll look at those in outcrop next time as well. So I'd like to introduce a model here that's a general model that works really well for the Permian Basin. It's called reciprocal sedimentation. So what we see that during relative high stands of sea level, we have the shelves are flooded. We have an opportunity for a lot of carbonate productivity, and we have storage space for siliciclastics in a very up dip position. So there are a lot of clastics in this system. They're just way up dip, and they're associated with these continental sabkas. So there's a lot of red beds that we'll look at next time as well. And then, so this is a prograding out, very little sand out in these positions here, and this is relatively starved in the basin. So the high stands are dominated by thick platform successions, progradational stacking patterns, relatively thin and starved basinal equivalents, and reservoir development associated with outer shelf bank margin into a middle shelf position through dolomitization. There's usually the interior deposits are dolomitized, it's pina contemporaneous, and the outer shelf to slope deposits are still limestone. So that's another enhancer of potential reservoir development. During a relative low stand of sea level, we're going to expose the shelf. There's no storage space for the clastics that will be bypassed across. And then by virtue of these relatively steep dips, they're going to be transported via sediment gravity flows to the lower slope and basin floor position. And these will onlap that slope. And then during the successive relative rise of sea level, you can develop of a sort of a mixed clastic carbonate low stand wedge. But often this is still an area of bypass depending on the depositional dips. And the next thing we'll see is transgressive sands equivalent to that same cycle of deposition trapped in a shelf position. So when you look at cross sections through Permian Basin, you'll see there'll be shelfal sands, there'll be basinal sands, and then often nothing but carbonate in between. And that's because of that bypass. So here's a seismic line from the east shelf part of the Midland Basin for the Clear Fork. And you see these same geometries, basically overall progradation here, a lot of probably internal cyclicity, some downstepping margins, but you see the onlap of the basin-restricted siliciclastics against these antecedent margins. And then in terms of where reservoirs would be, obviously you've got the high stand carbonates have potential, and then these basin-restricted sands would. So those of you who are familiar with the Permian Basin, we're talking about things like the Bone Spring sands, first, second, and third Bone Spring sands. We're talking about the Brushy, Cherry, and Bell Canyon. We're talking about the Dean and the Sprayberry sands in the Midland Basin. So as we go drop into Bone Canyon, we're kind of in the guts of this big transport system. And what you see sitting right on the cutoff formation is a complicated stack of conglomerates up to boulder size, class, and turbiditic sandstones. So these, you can see there's a conglomerate, sand, conglomerate, sand, another conglomerate here. And when we look at these up close, these are more matrix supported than not. They tend to be unbedded. They're poorly sorted, some very angular blocks here. and a variety of lithofacies in the carbonate. There are some siltstone class also, but these are dominantly carbonate class in a sandstone matrix. This is probably, again, mostly a mass transport complex, whereas the these bedded sands above and below are kind of classic turbidites. One thing I'll just riff on a little bit here, what's kind of a little weird about the Permian Basin is there's not much clay in the system. So these are not the turbidites, the clay portion is only represented by silt. There's not a lot of clay. And I think that's because it was a very arid environment. They're extremely feldspathic. The fine-grained sands and silts are hot on the gamma ray because of potassium feldspar. And so the feldspars are not being weathered out to clay. Big contorted beds here, obviously deposited really quick and loaded with this conglomerate above. And so we've been looking at this system right here in Bone Canyon. And so you see the big stack of sand and conglomerates at the base there. And this is the full succession here. So we kind of looked at this stuff here. We go up through some TBTC beds, and there's an interesting succession of carbonate turbidites. You know, up packed stones through mudstones that have TABs and TBTCs, and then mostly a whole bunch of TCs on top with a few TATB beds, but this is mostly a current rippled cap, and then we go into siltstone above. So this is basically an abandonment succession at the top, and this is at the top of what's called a middle brushy member here. So what I'd like to do is just kind of close with a final look at this again from the Hedberg publication. So this is this full succession. You see the really coarse grain stuff in the bottom, and then kind of this kind of fining up cap. And so we don't use the term, well, at least I don't like to use the term flooding surface in deep water, because it kind of has no meaning. And I think a preferred term is abandonment surface. So this system is moving away here. And then the question is this avulsive related, or is this truly cyclic? So now we're going to take a look at rest area gully, as I recall, is next. Oh no, yeah. So this is that cross section again. We just did this gig here, did this traverse between these two canyons. Now we're going to move out basinally, sitting right below the last peak of the Guadalupe Mountains, El Capitan. So now we're going to get a closer look at this cutoff lithology, and we're going to talk about unconventional resources. Notice also how discontinuous these sands are in its updip position. And we're going to close with a discussion of what the basin floor deposits look like as expressed here in the Delaware Mountain section. So we're off to rest area gully. We're distal here to where we were before. It's a little off camera here, but it sits in this position. You can walk to it from the main road there. It's at the rest area, thus the colorful name. The bottom part of the section that's exposed here, we don't have Bone Spring anymore. We start out in the lower cutoff. And remember that GP1 sequence boundary? It was always a carbonate on carbonate surface where we saw it, with cutoff lithologies below and above. Well, here we actually see that there's a sandstone and conglomerate developed on top of it. So this is my little kind of sketch section of that. This is the sequence boundary. There's a kind of a lag surface with carbonate cobbles on top. You go through an intermediate lithology, and then most of the section is made up of this low angle, cross-bedded, very fine sandstone with these clasts, these carbonate clasts in it. So up to cobble size. And that's what we call, at least informally, the middle cutoff sandstone. It's capped with some carbonate turbidites, and then we go back into sort of normal cutoff lithologies. You see all the contorted bedding, so again, pretty rapid deposition. So now we do see one of these basin-restricted sands developed on this sequence boundary, whereas up dip, all we saw was a bypass surface. This is from a student's thesis at UT, worked for Charlie Hurd. And here's this GP1 sequence boundary. Here's our rest area gully section. And he sees the basically onlap of this section as he takes it up towards a stratotype canyon. So we're seeing on a kind of a miniature scale one of these developments of one of these basin-restricted slope to basin floor sandstone systems. he has a variety of, and he's sort of, he's a carbonate sedimentologist, so he emphasizes the carbonate part, so I'll have a little different riff on it, but he sees a variety of lithofaces in the cutoff, in the upper and lower cutoff. He sees these finer grained units here, here, and here that I would basically posit that these are maximum flooding surfaces associated with the intervening sequence boundary, the GP1. So let's take a look at the different lithofaces in a gross sense that we see within the cutoff. You see a lot of kind of medium bedded lime, wacky stone, packstones. You can find some little kind of wimpy carbonate turbidites in that. And then you see this very fissile unit here that's dark colored. When you break it open, it stinks. And it's a much finer grain, and it has a lot of siliceous material in it. The cutoff in the subsurface, is, as I said, is lumped with the Bone Spring, and it is equivalent to the upper portion of the so-called Avalon Zone, which is an important unconventional oil target in the northern Delaware Basin. So I guess the question here is which of these faces is the more promising from both a petroleum source rock and unconventional reservoir? So here's a couple of thin sections from another thesis. This is from the subsurface. These are all stained with alizarin red S, so the calcite is going to appear as pink. What we see in this facies is that it's mostly carbonate, and it has small skeletal debris in it. It's got a little bit of quartz silt, I should say, and that's a sponge spicule there. This stuff has very little carbonate. It's got a lot of quartz silt. It's got radiolarians. There are some spicules as well. And you see this dark stuff is a lot of kerogen in this. So lithologically, they're very different. You also see very large slumps in the cutoff as well. These are up to about 5 to 10 meter in scale. You see these recumbent folds here. So this is due to Pina contemporaneous slope failure. And so that's very ubiquitous through the cutoff in both kinds of lithofaces. So let's take a look at some analytical data from a couple of pieces of work. First, just in terms of well log correlation, is that the carbonates correspond with very low gamma ray excursions. And when you get low carbonate, basically is where the hot radioactive zones are. And the question is what is that radioactivity due to? Well, I think there's two elements to it. One is that we do have uranium, and you look at a spectral gamma ray, you see there's pretty high uranium counts in this, and that's complexed on organic matter. Secondly, they lump it with quartz in this display here, but much of the fine grain silt-sized particles are actually potassium feldspars, and they're also radioactive. When we look at total organic carbon content, it's inversely proportional to carbonate content. So carbonate muds and grains are basically diluting this. And if you want to be in this sort of above 2% TOC, you want to basically not be in a nice kind of well-behaved limestone. Instead, when you look at this, here's porosity versus these mineralogical components. So this is basically silica content here. This is clay and this is kerogen. So porosity is correlated with kerogen and quartz. I'll point out that people call these shale reservoirs. That's kind of stupid. They're not shales as we think about them. And I know it's a convenient term, but these all have less than 25% clay. If they had a lot of clay in it, they wouldn't be reservoirs. So even though they're fissile, they're really, what we're talking about is very silica-rich units. And the silica is of two parts. It's both detrital silt, and it's also biogenic silica related to both siliceous sponge spicules and radiolarians. So now let's talk about the brushy. So the brushy has been defined informally into three units, a lower brushy canyon, a middle, and an upper. And these are punctuated by silt-rich zones in between. And where we were in the Bone Canyon area would be in this position where the lower brushy is already on lapped out. We're going to start our rest area traverse in the brushy in a position where we just have the uppermost part of the brushy that has this siltstone unit, and the sandy lower part is been on lapped out, and then we'll get a look at the rest of this succession there. So this is from several pieces of work composited. This is a kind of a simplified herd section for the cutoff. This is the sandstone conglomerate sitting on top. This is our GP2 sequence boundary. And this is a total organic carbon and hydrogen index curve. And I've kind of smoothed it visually. What we see is that there's a rich zone. It gets lean even in the siltstones. There's another rich zone. It gets lean. And then at the top of the brushy, we have a third rich zone. So let's go walk through the facies. What we see is that in rest area gully, the brushy has got a lot of these planar laminated and current rippled thin bedded sandstones. And you see a number of these channel cuts. And so what's interesting, these erosional based channels are not always filled with sand. Often we see organic rich siltstones draping these, and that's this dark colored stuff. So this is a typical look at the facies where we got, you know, TB, TC, and then TD beds with this organic rich siltstones, but overall pretty fine grained. The way this has been interpreted is that we had erosional cut here, and sands, by virtue of turbidites, were flowing down this, but it was abandoned and then backfilled by basically hemipelagic draping units. Another view, this is one that's filled a little bit sandier, but still relatively thin bedded. You see there's about, well, you know, Christine's about 1.8 meters, so you can do the math on that. And then these also show a lot of soft sediment deformation as well. And then rarely you see debrites in the brushy, and this is just one, you know, tiny example. You see it's got a convex top. It does have a sharp base, although debrites often don't show a lot of erosion at the base. It has floating clasts in it and very obscure internal stratification, so we would interpret this as a debrite, but the vast majority of siliciclastic sand deposition in the basin is associated with what we would say would be turbidites instead. So these are these organic rich siltstones is what they look like from a distance. And while they can occur anywhere, you'll see that they preferentially occur in certain parts of the sedimentary section. So here's some outcrop analyses of the Brushy Canyon through both the sand and the siltstone section. So we do have some decent source rocks here, over 150 HI and 2 to 5% TOC. This is the condensed section at top of the brushy, the basal Cherry Canyon. And again, some good source rock. So the way we kind of view this is that we have this master, very large sequence boundary at the GP2, but then the brushy is punctuated by a finer scale cyclicity that we would call fourth order. So the base of the middle and the upper brushy are interpreted as sequence boundaries within an overall low stand sequence set. And these organic rich siltstones occur preferentially above these abandonment surfaces, and they're associated with fourth order maximum flooding surfaces. So if we go back to here, this diagram, we'd say sequence boundary, MFS. We put another sequence boundary in about this position, another MFS, another sequence boundary, and this is the ultimate third order MFS at the top here. And you see you got up to 5% TOC. So while organic rich source rocks to some degree can occur anywhere in a succession, there is a sort of a cyclic underpinnings to that. And that's because with each of these abandonment surfaces, you're gonna have a potential for less dilution and organic enrichment of the sedimentary section. So we're gonna move down to the Delaware Mountains, which you cannot visit anymore because Jeff Bezos has bought all these ranches, which is an embittering experience for me. So this is a Guadalupe Canyon in the Delaware Mountains. And so you're seeing some of these really large scale, that's 60 meters for scale, confined channel deposits. And see, they have a relatively flat top. They have the, what they call the steerhead morphology. At least some people use that term because it got the sort of the thin horns and the channel margin position. And then we've got the head kind of sticking in here. Let's look at this particular pan a little bit more close. What we see is that these sands tend to be packaged on sharp erosional contacts. They're onlapping the edges. And in this case, there actually is kind of an offset stacking, so there may be some migration of the channel axis. But also recognize that sometimes these things are filled with siltstone, just like we saw before. So here's a erosional base, a slope channel, but this was backfilled instead with silt. So think about the stratigraphic trapping potential of these things. Not only do we have channel margins, but we also have potential erosion and backfilling with fine-grained material as well. And sometimes you see fairly, it's a little hard to see here, but this can be very complicated channel margin relationships here. So this is not necessarily just one master surface. It may be a kind of a composite surface with channel margin features. So here's an example of stratigraphic traps in these confined channel complexes. This is from Nobel Canyon. You see this is from Shirley Dutton's work, and you see these Bell Canyon fields are oriented along these slope channel complexes. This is a cross-section and shows some of these reservoir zones, so you see the nature of it. But, you know, again, this is a more complicated permeability story than I'm going to be telling here. Structure map, no apparent trapping mechanism, but when you look at a isopach map for one of the reservoir zones, you basically see that you got these sausages of sand. So there's kind of two ways globally you can trap these confined channel complexes. The best way, which happens very commonly in places like Angola and Nigeria, is to basically drape the margin along a nose of structural strike. And so the margin actually provides a trap. An alternative way is you basically can have permeability plugs along the axis due to areas of bypass or finer grain deposition or subsequent erosion by a mud-filled channel. And that obviously occurs in this field, but it also occurs in fields in the North Sea, such as the Alba field on the Flaten Ground Spur. So we're going to move down dip to Colleen Canyon and see what happens to these slope channel complexes. We're seeing a little different morphology here. See how extensive overall in Colleen Canyon these sands are. We're still seeing some erosion at the bottom here, but there's a lot of sand here that's equivalent to there. So we're not seeing as a same aspect ratio. And when you look up close, this is a road cut on the other side of the canyon. You actually see that while superficially more sheet-like, there still is a lot of channelization of these bodies. So this has been interpreted as the channel to sheet transition in kind of a lower slope to toe slope position. And so we've kind of gone from this stuff here, where we're in the slope channel complexes, to this transition channel to sheets, where this unit is becoming more distributive. And then finally, I'd like to close with what happens in a most distal position. This is on the Sibley Ranch. And what we see there is that these are essentially sheet sands, but even here we see that there's kind of a change from the axial part of these distributive complexes to the margins. And, you know, this is really well seen in places like the Karoo and Ross, et cetera. So even these sheet-like bodies have, you know, some changes from axial to marginal positions, but it occurs at a much longer distance, much better lateral connectivity. So just to kind of close on this, we've gone all the way from up-dip submarine canyons to slope channel complex, down all the way through what is kind of people think of as classically as a basin floor fan. And this model is a general one. Obviously, it can be articulated different ways in different systems, but it's a general model that works many places with submarine fans. And I think that is all I have. So, any questions? Last few minutes. If you're all left.
Thank you, Kurt. That's an excellent presentation you've given so far. I'm excited for next week. If there is any questions.
I can't hear you, Michaela.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, I can hear you, Michaela.
Okay.
Oops, hold on. I got it. My bad. I had my my speaker was turned off.
Oh, that's no worries. No worries.
That's on me.
I was thanking you for a great presentation. I'm really excited for next Friday. We have about 10 minutes for questions if anyone has questions.
I know that's a lot of stuff. So
I got a question.
Okay, go ahead, Michael.
It seemed like the theme is this interbedded carbonates and siliciclastics, right? And so I guess that has everything to do with the unconventional production of this area, right?
Yeah, so it's really interesting. I still feel like I'm pretty ignorant, and there's probably been some later work that may have articulated this. But if you look at industry overall, how they've approached it, it's been extremely empirical. And there hasn't been as much genetic understanding as you'd like. It's kind of like it's where we find it. And so they experiment a lot in the field with, you know, completions and landing the wells correctly, and they find something that works, and they replicate that, and they optimize it. And so there's a lot of joy in that. But in terms of a genetic understanding, it really looks like when you look at some of these zones in the Bone Spring, there's a Bone Spring sandstone play, but the unconventional play tends to be in these finer grain portions that are in the transition between the sandy part and the carbonate part that has a lot of organic richness. It's hot on the gamma ray. It actually has quite a bit of porosity, and is made up of, and it's not clay. It's not a shale. Okay. It's made up of a lot of detrital and biogenic silica, and the carbonate content is subsidiary to that. And so that occurs in this kind of what in a sequence stratigraphic sense we would call them with the maximum flooding surface. So that's kind of fits the paradigm for where source rocks are developed. And the fact that this is this kind of reciprocal carbonate clastic alternating system, I just want to riff on that for a second. People kind of think that clastics are sort of certain death on carbonates, but it's really more clay is death on carbonates. And there's places like Belize you can go to where you can have coeval siliciclastic and carbonate environments that are basically interfinger in time. So there's two ways that carbonates and clastics can interact. There's this sort of temporal cyclicity, and there also can be kind of a spatial, you know, between where our depocenters are. I don't even know if I answered your question, but
no, thank you.
Yeah. So any other comments or and this basin is so complicated, and I have very incomplete knowledge. So if anybody has any, you know, experience they want to share that differs from this, that's cool too.
Go ahead, Tyson.
I had a question, just a kind of a general question about the Delaware and Midland basins in terms of what are the thoughts on why you had such kind of prolific either organic material preservation, concentration, production, you know, any kind of combination of those? Why do they think that this system is the way that it is with regard to the amount of organic material that we see preserved here?
So
in comparison to other basins kind of around and happening at the same time, or in
I'll mention two things about Permian Basin being prolific. One thing, it's just very kind of more moronic is, there's just lots of source rocks all the way back to the Ordovician Simpson. So we got this stack of, you know, and Simpson is a little mysterious, but we have the Woodford, the Barnett, you have the Upper Pennsylvanian, which actually they unfortunately call Wolf Camp in the subsurface. The Wolf Camp D is actually Pennsylvanian in age. You have the Wolf Camp, you have the Bone Spring. Some of these younger ones probably don't get mature. So that's very forgiving. But in terms of the Permian in particular, I think the fact that this was a relatively enclosed hydrology, it leads to dysoxia. I think the lack of clay because of aridity is not a bad thing either, because you don't have the dilution of all this clay raining down. And so you have these relatively starved basins during maximum flooding time. And the other thing is that this is one of the higher, especially the Delaware, is one of the higher relief of these arm basins in terms of bathymetric relief. And that will enhance the nutrient aspects due to upwelling. So I think there was probably a really good upwelling margins on this, where in a more sort of lower angle system, you wouldn't have. So that would be kind of a hypothesis that I would propose, is those factors, you know, climate, physiography, and depth of the basin, and the closed hydrology that, you know, allows dysoxia to develop.
Okay.
I don't know, but if somebody's got a better idea, I'll steal it. So.
All right. I think we have time for one more question. If no one would like to go, I can ask my question. I would like your opinion, Kurt, on what you think the effects are of having minimal clay content in this basin. How does that really affect production overall? Is this part of the reason why it's a prolific basin? Things like that. I just want your opinion on it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, one thing you do lack with the clay is these kind of, this more sort of bimodal seal reservoir aspects. And so there's a lot more complicated permeability traps, I would say. And in fact, what you see in the fields is it's often hard to establish contacts. It can be different segments that have different contacts. And then a real common phenomenon is that there's these residual oil zones where things rotate. So the permeability structure, I think, as a result of a lack of clay in the system, is more complex. And, you know, carbonates in general have very complicated pore and permeability structures as well. So I hadn't actually thought of that as a question, so I kind of winged it on that, but that would be my answer.
Sounds good to me. I think Zoe might have had a question. Was that true?
Sure.
Yeah, well, thank you so much for the great presentation. It was more than what I can digest as a geophysicist. But you mentioned something, it's kind of totally off topic, but what is Jeff Bezos doing in Guadalupe Mountain?
What is what doing?
Jeff Bezos doing there.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I'm going to try and make this short and not too bitter. But you know, it was actually the company I used to work for was the first to actually get into these ranches, because we had a business relationship with Tony, who owned the Sibley and Six Bar, because he was a pipeline, had a pipeline company, and for some reason he liked us. So we got on the ranch, and then he turned it into a little, originally he let us on free, and then he started charging us, and then he figured I could make a business out of this. And so universities and other companies would visit, and it spawned, like, you know, a nice little suite of research projects, including some PhDs and et cetera. So that was cool. And then Jeff Bezos has built this Blue Origins space company, and his launch facility is down near Van Horn at the southern end of the Delaware Mountains. And he bought all these ranches as buffer. So when they do a launch, they actually have to close down. I think it's 54 is the state highway between Guadalupe Pass and Van Horn. So he wanted basically this acreage buffer. And we actually tried to talk to Amazon or Blue Origins to try and get access and explain what we were doing scientifically and try and secure access for universities and such. And they, the short version of the story is they could care less. And so I know maybe some I know one university in particular, they sort of hopped the fence to look at the Guadalupe Canyon stuff, even though it's on his land. But, you know, in general, most of the land is off limits now. And that's the story. I could tell you sadder parts, like firing the ranch manager.
Oh, God. Thanks.
Yeah.
Just curious.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you guys for asking questions. I would like to thank everyone for participating and attending this little workshop we're doing. Just a reminder, our second session, which is a follow-up on this, kind of building out further, will be next Friday on the 23rd, I believe it is. Yes, the 23rd at 1 to 2:30 Central Time as well. So thanks again, Kurt, and we should see you guys next Friday.
Okay. Thanks, everybody. Talk to you later.